هيا على الفلاح.
And once I love this person, Allah says, I will become his hearing with which he hears, his sight with which he sees, his hand with which he strikes, his legs with which he walks. And if he was to ask anything of me, I shall fulfill it. And if he was to seek refuge in me against anything, I shall grant him refuge.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful to us than a mother is to her child. And I want you to absorb what that means. I want you to think about a mother for her child. I want you to think about what a mother would do for her child, what a mother would do to protect her child. And then I want you to think about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how Allah's mercy is infinitely more than that. Allah's mercy is the source of all other mercy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not waiting to put us in hell. Allah is waiting to forgive us.
What does it mean to be loved by Allah? And how can one gain this love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
And the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala towards his servants is something that is rarely spoken about, to the point where many people see it as more of a Christian concept than an Islamic concept. But the truth is that one of the names of Allah azza wa jal is that he is al-wadud, which means the loving, which means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the believers. In fact, love is the essence of our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, whoever of you abandons his religion, indeed Allah is going to bring forth a people that he loves and they love him back. So why did the verse start with love? Of all the other emotions and feelings, why did it start with love towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Why not those that fear him, or obey him, or worship him? Why love in particular? And the scholars say because it is what your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is based upon. It is based upon love. And what is amazing about the verse is that it starts with the love of Allah azza wa jal towards his servants. يُحِبُّهُمْ, then they return the love, يُحِبُّونَهُ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then loves the believers. This is expressed multiple times in the Quran. One of the most unique ones is in Surah Al-Buruj. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes himself saying, and he is the forgiving, the most forgiving, and the loving. The scholars say, it makes more sense to combine Ghafoor with Rahim. And 69 times in the Quran you will find Ghafoorun Rahim, Ghafooran Rahima. But in one time only, and this is the only time in the Quran, in Surah Al-Buruj, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, وَهُوَ الْغَفُورُ الْوَدُودِ, the forgiving and the loving. Why the loving in particular? Because you might forgive someone for something they've done against you, but you still dislike them in your heart. Or you might even still hate them in your heart. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to know that He will forgive you from a sin and still keep loving you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unlike the rest of humanity, unlike human beings. Allah will forgive you for a sin. And not because you sin, it means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hate you immediately. And we see this in other places in the Quran. Allah azza wa jal says, indeed Allah loves those who constantly repent. And He loves those who purify themselves. So no doubt we can agree that there is no way you can constantly repent from nothing. You have to constantly repent from doing sins. Allah loves those who constantly repent. That means you can keep constantly sinning and still be loved by Allah Azza wa Jal, so long as you sincerely keep repenting back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you know this understanding, far be it from the shaitan to come to you and make you think that you are dirty because of your sins, or that you are hated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of your sins. And if we were to contemplate, what would be the effects of worshipping a Lord that you believed hated you? What would be the effects of that on your worship? Would you be energetic in wanting to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Would you like to spend hours and hours making dua and talking to Allah azza wa jal? Would you like to do extra acts of worship to this Lord that hates you? Will you ever feel that you'll be forgiven, or that you will enter al-Jannah, or that you have a chance with a Lord who hates you? And the bigger question, would you even love back a Lord that you believe hates you? Would you love him if he hates you? And that's why this topic is so important, brothers and sisters. One of the Christian scholars, he did a study amongst the Christians to see which of the three of the triune gods, the Father, the Son, and the Spirit, which one is more beloved by Christians. And he found that the majority of Christians love what is, according to them, God the Son, more than God the Father. Why? Because they perceive God the Father as the angry one who could not forgive people for thousands of years. And then God the Son is the loving one who stepped forward and said, I will give myself up for their sins. So they love him more because they perceive more love coming out of him. And people naturally will gravitate towards a Lord that loves them versus the God of hatred or the God of war. And we're talking about the polytheists here. So then, what are the fruits and the benefits of when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you? In Sahih Bukhari, this is a hadith narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, when Allah loves one of his servants, he calls Jibreel. And then he says, indeed Allah loves so and so, so love him. And then instantly, Jibreel will instantly love that person. Then Jibreel will call to the people of the heavens, meaning to the angels in the heavens. Indeed Allah loves so and so, so all of you love him. And then he will be loved by those in the heavens, meaning all the angels in the heavens.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send al-qabulu lahu fil ard. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Allah will send down for him al-qabul. Al-qabul means acceptance, and means that people will feel easy around this individual. They love this individual. So wherever this person goes, they'll find people welcoming them everywhere they go. Now subhanAllah, there are so many people around you. You know that whenever you see them, you just rejoice. You become excited. You're so happy just to see them coming. And there are some other people, the moment you see them, you feel a little bit uneasy about the presence around you. SubhanAllah, all of this aura coming from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, blessings for these people, that they became among those who are very, very actually helpful to others. They're very nice and kind. It's by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah loves them and he sends this love for them amongst the people as well. On the other hand, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala detests somebody, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he dislikes someone, he calls upon Jibreel. Ya Jibreel, I dislike this person. You should dislike him as well. So Jibreel dislikes this individual and he sends the message among the angels as well that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dislikes this person. So all the angels in heavens will dislike and despise this individual because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well does that. So therefore, wherever this individual goes, unfortunately wouldn't be welcomed as the first person. So that is the meaning of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's loves for someone. That Allah subhanahu opens so many paths for them in their lives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them loved by all those people who are around them. So look at yourself and imagine yourself in this world. And now this is the message that this ayah carries for you. Are you among those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves or not? And if your life is going so easy for you, maybe this is a good sign that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves something about you. Look at that and try to increase it in your life. Look at what you do right and increase it, inshaAllah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And if you see things are not going the way they should be, Allahu a'lam, maybe this is something, there is something wrong that you need to fix and work on, inshaAllah azza wa jal.
So the question becomes, how do we attain the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Because every Muslim on earth claims they love Allah azza wa jal. Even if they don't pray, they will tell you, I don't pray, but I love Allah azza wa jal. But the real question is, does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love you? And that's why it behooves us to know what are some of the things that will gain or get you the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Number one is obeying and following the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In Surah Al-Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to inform us. Say, if you truly love Allah, then follow me and Allah will love you. And on top of that, he will forgive your sins. But this is then the place of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the place of an-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam as a guide and a role model for the rest of us. The sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is greater than something that is just optional. We can do if we feel like and we discard if we don't feel like it. It is a way to attain one of the greatest things ever, and that is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Sahih Bukhari, narrated by Abu Huraira as well, radiallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, so it's a Qudsi hadith, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, whoever shows enmity or animosity is an enemy to one of my awliya, to one of my close friends. You angered or you hurt with statements or with actions, a wali. So then the question is, what is a wali? Who is a wali of Allah Azza wa Jal? Some of the scholars said a wali is a alim, a scholar. And others said, no, a wali is a mu'min. And they use the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Allah is the wali of those who believe. So the believers in general, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, whoever is a mu'min, a believer, who is God-fearing, he is a wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then the hadith is saying, so whoever shows enmity towards a wali of Allah, Allah declared war against him. And Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he declares war against a servant, he destroys him. So that means beware of having any animosity towards any Muslim, because you don't know which one of them is from the friends of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what is amazing, brothers and sisters, is that there's always a link in Islam. There's always a link between your relationship with Allah and how that links to your relationship and your dealings with other fellow human beings. So then the hadith continues, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, my servant will not get close to me with anything more beloved to me than what I've made obligatory upon him, like the obligatory prayers, obligatory fast. But remember, we're seeing what gets you the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the hadith continues, and my servants will continue to draw near to me with nawafil until I love them. Nawafil, the scholars say, not just the nawafil in salawat, the extra prayers, but any of the extra good deeds. So nawafil in salah, the nawafil of sadaqah, giving extra charity, extra fast, extra umrah, all these are from the nawafil. You keep continuously doing that to get near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala until Allah azza wa jal says, hatta uhibbahu, until I love him or love her. And if I love him, I will be the hearing with which he hears, and the eyes with which he sees, and the hand with which he strikes, and the legs with which he walks. Meaning, he will not see, hear, or do anything except that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves or is pleased with. Or in other words, Allah Azza wa Jal will protect their limbs from what Allah Azza wa Jal is displeased with. Extra bonus points, and if he asks me, I will give him. And that if he asks and seeks refuge from me, refuge will be given to him. All this is from the benefits of when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. So far we have then, you can gain the love of Allah Azza wa Jal by obeying and following the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you can do that also, the second point, by continuously doing the nawafil to get near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then you see that the things that will gain you the love of Allah Azza wa Jal, a lot of them are extremely easy. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrates that my love is deserved or even obligated in another narration for those who love each other for my sake. And then it's obligatory for Allah Azza wa Jal to love you. And then the hadith continues, and for those who visit each other for my sake, and those who help one another for my sake, and the scholars said financially help each other for the sake of Allah, and those who uphold ties with one another. It's not even talking about families. It's talking about upholding ties with brothers and members of the community for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. You get the love of Allah Azza wa Jal. Simple things. Loving each other for the sake of Allah, visiting each other, assisting each other financially, keeping ties with one another, you gain the love of Allah Azza wa Jal. And we're familiar with these concepts because further proof is a famous hadith in Sahih Muslim of the angel that was sent to a man. And this man set out to visit his friend at another town. So Allah sends him an angel to ask him, where are you going? The man says, to visit my brother in this town. So the angel says, have you any favor to him, to do for him or that he's going to do for you? And the man says, no. He says, I have no desire except to visit him because I love him for the sake of Allah. So the angel tells this man, I am a messenger of Allah to you, to inform you that Allah loves you as you loved him for his sake. Something that we need to be aware of that can happen if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. Narrated by At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet says, when Allah intends good for his servants, He hastens the punishment for him in this dunya. And if he intends evil for his servant, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will keep their sins with them until they meet Allah with their sins on the Day of Judgment. And some of the scholars said this is specific to the munafiq. But the question, brothers and sisters, some people might ask, what kind of love is this? Yani, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves me, He gives me difficulty and tests in this world, so what kind of love is that? And we have two answers for this. Number one, what is greater than the blessing of coming forth on the Day of Judgment without any sins, or with far less sins because they were expiated because of the difficulties in this life? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to meet Him on the Day of Judgment without sins. So He gives you difficulties that will erase your sins right here on this earth. And we are people who always think of the next life, so we see the benefits. If we only believed in one life, we wouldn't see that as love. But because we believe in the next life, we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is removing your sins from you, expiating you of your sins, so you meet Him without any or with very few. And that's why Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he used to say, he said, had it not been for the calamities, we would have come forth bankrupt on the Day of Judgment. But it's these calamities that take away from our sins. The second thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He tests you, He brings you closer to Him. When you love someone, you want them to be close to you. You want them near to you. And one of the most effective ways for humans to get close to their Creator is at times of need. Compare the dua of someone in need and in distress to someone that has no problems. There was a man who said that he had a specific family problem. So for a year and a half, he never missed Qiyamul Layl. So that means he never missed Fajr for a year and a half, and he never slept before praying Isha for a year and a half, and he always made Qiyam. Then he says, this was 7 years ago. After a year and a half, Allah fixed my problem, and for the last 7 years, I've never gotten up for Qiyam. And I've constantly missed Fajr and slept before praying Isha. You see the difference between your acts of worship, your relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal at times of need and when everything is okay. So do you understand why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then will test the people that He loves? An important issue we conclude with, and something to not be misunderstood from this khutbah. If everything is going well in your life, that does not mean that Allah Azza wa Jal hates you. We do not reverse this concept that if Allah loves you, He tests you. You don't reverse it. If you're not being tested, it means you're hated by Allah. This is just the shaitan trying to distance you from your Lord. And the best of people, brothers and sisters, are those who excel in the worship of Allah Azza wa Jal during times of ease and during times of difficulty. With that, we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us of those that He loves and to make us of those that love Him back. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us of those who recognize the truth as clear truth and follow the best of it. And to make us of those who recognize falsehood as clear falsehood and abstain from it. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant victory to Islam and to the Muslims. وصلى اللهم وبارك على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.